Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. The era of super PACs could be at an end, but that won't happen if the public doesn't get involved. We'll give you the details. Governments across the globe are trying to find a way to avoid the next economic meltdown, but here in the U.S., Republicans are trying to dismantle the few banking regulations that are actually in place. And Ben Carson's own advisors are terrified that he might actually get elected. We'll bring you more in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flag.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Next year's presidential elections are going to set records for the amount of money spent on U.S. politics, and that's all thanks to super PACs. But with all the focus on the corrupting influence of money in politics, and polls showing that a majority of Americans oppose big money in elections, could the era of super PACs be at an end? For more on this, let's go to John Bonifaz, co-founder and president of Free Speech for People. So, John, before we really get into the heart of the issue of what Free Speech for People is working towards here, I think it's important that we kind of step back and we get a little bit of a primer. You know, we've had campaign donations going into politics for a very long time. But now in this era of super PACs, we have this, you know, virtually unlimited stream of money. So what's the difference between the way things used to be versus this era of super PACs?
Well, you're absolutely correct that we had a problem of big money in elections prior to the era of super PACs and prior to the Citizens United ruling from the Supreme Court in January of 2010. But what we have seen as a result of this super PAC era is an explosion of campaign spending in our elections beyond anything that has happened before. Now, literally hundreds of millions of dollars can pour into these vehicles known as super PACs from the very, very rich of our society, the millionaires and billionaires, to try to distort our election process and to effectively buy our government. And the danger here is, of course, not only one of corruption, as serious as that is, it is really a threat to the basic promise of American democracy, of, by, and for the people, and a political equality promise that is rooted in the one person, one vote principle. So when we have the very, very rich effectively determining who gets to run and who gets to win in our elections, and then what policies get set, what the agenda is for our government, that is not, in essence, a democracy. It's on the road to a plutocracy, and it's a real threat to our republic.
And so right now, you know, we have the two front runners on the Democratic side, both Hillary Clinton and Senator Bernie Sanders. You know, Bernie Sanders does not have any super PACs. Hillary does, but she's also getting a lot of money from these small donors directly to the campaign. And then you contrast that with what we have on the other side, and that seems to be just the super PAC bunch. I mean, and as you pointed out, these super PACs, they're not being funded by regular people. You know, if somebody wants to give money to a campaign, they give money to a campaign, you know, $10 or $50. But the super PACs, by and large, the majority of the money going in there is from millionaires and billionaires, and that gives them almost complete control.
Right. I mean, in fact, the New York Times did a study not so long ago demonstrating that 158 families out of the entire country, out of the entire population of the United States, 158 families have given more than half of all money now, spent all money in terms of the presidential election thus far in this cycle. That is a phenomenal amount of money coming from such a small segment, small, tiny slice of our society. And it does distort our election process, and it does undermine the promise of democracy. We did have a serious problem of money in politics before the super PAC era, but it has gotten exponentially worse, and it has demonstrated why we must fight to to take our democracy back with the 28th Amendment to the Constitution to overturn these Supreme Court rulings that have allowed for unlimited campaign spending and to allow for overall limits in our elections. And at the same time that we do that, we must push forward other reforms like public funding of elections, like greater disclosure, to really reclaim our democracy. But the super PAC era in particular is in danger of being challenged in the courts because the federal appeals court ruling that allowed for super PACs is vulnerable to such a challenge. And that's something that we're very engaged in developing at Free Speech for People.
And one of the things you just hit on is the issue of transparency. And so with super PACs, I know there's different classifications. I don't know all of them, but in some cases, they do not have to disclose where the money came from, correct?
They do not have to disclose right away. Eventually, we can learn who's giving to the super PACs, but you're correct that some of these entities, like 501c4 entities that are now being used to essentially put large sums of money into our elections, they are able to hide completely their donors. And then out of the Citizens United ruling from the Supreme Court, which swept away a century of precedent barring corporate money elections, corporations are now directly allowed to spend money in elections. And there are no disclosure laws that have yet to be passed by Congress, despite efforts to do so, to require disclosure of corporate political spending. So there are a number of ways in which secret money is flowing into our political process that further undermines that promise of democracy.
I think one of the real ironies with this entire super PAC era is the fact that the campaign finance issue itself shows that corporations have already won. Because when you look at polls, you have a vast majority of Republicans, Democrats, and independents. So most of the people in this country that Congress and their government is supposed to represent want big money gone out of politics. But because we now have this unlimited corporate money, our government is not going to do anything about it because they need the money. So right there on this very issue, we see the influence and we see that it seems like the average people don't have a voice right now.
Well, we don't have a voice in the halls of Washington in terms of the majorities, although there are many members of Congress who are on record now calling for an amendment. But where we do have a voice is at the grassroots level. And all across this country, since the Supreme Court's ruling in Citizens United v. FEC more than 5 years ago, there's been a huge movement built to reclaim our democracy, to press for a 28th Amendment to overturn that ruling and to allow for overall spending limits in our elections, to challenge the basic claim of money equaling speech and corporations being treated as people. And in fact, there's been a lot of other reforms that have been pressed forward in the states, such as public funding of elections. Even just 2 weeks ago, the state of Maine and the city of Seattle passed model public funding laws. So there is an enormous movement being built at the grassroots level, and that's where the pressure can come eventually to Washington, and that's where our voices will be heard. You know, this is on the scale of prior crises that we have faced in our democracy, in our history, from the challenge to the right to vote for African Americans during the Civil Rights Movement, to the women's suffrage movement. All of these movements have required people at the grassroots level standing up and fighting back. And that's what we have today, is an emerging democracy movement to reclaim our republic and the basic promise of political equality for all.
And, with the events that happened in Ferguson, Missouri, everything with the Iraq War, we've seen, in the last 10, 15 years, the public does seem to be getting much more active again, and that is a very good thing. There are a lot of issues that we have to fight for, and seeing this activism rising is certainly a very positive step. Real quick, how can people support Free Speech for People?
Well, we'd love it if people join our campaign at freespeechforpeople.org, sign up, visit our resources page, get your organizer's toolkit, help mobilize your neighbors, your friends, your community to call for this 28th Amendment to reclaim our democracy. We are going to reclaim our republic because we will stand up together all across this country, millions of Americans across the political spectrum, regardless of your political affiliation. We have a common vision of our government, of, by, and for the people. And at the end of the day, the big money forces will not win out. We the people will win. It is we the people, not we the corporations and big money interests, that shall govern in America.
John Bonifaz, Free Speech for People, freespeechforpeople.org. Visit the website. Support them any way you can. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you so much.
Fearing another financial meltdown, governments across the globe are uniting to try to come up with tighter regulations on the banking industry to prevent the kinds of problems that caused the financial crisis of 2007. And while the rest of the world recognizes the problems, Republicans in the U.S. are actually trying to weaken the few protections that are currently in place. Joining me now to explain what's happening is Michael Burg. Michael, we have a very interesting, dichotomy happening here. We have, on the one hand, the global banking leaders, regulators, agencies, saying, look, we've got to do something to kind of get these banks in line. Meanwhile, over here in the United States, we have Republicans saying we've got to give them everything they've ever wanted. So before we get into this kind of Republican deregulation myth, take us through the global issue and why they recognize a problem when we in the United States clearly do not.
Well, I think the world recognizes from the collapse that occurred in 2008 that we have some of these banks that are way, way too large, you know, too big to fail. And what they're saying is, you know, let's start with the financial stability board, which is an international board, in which they're saying, look, the 30 largest banks in the world need to raise at least $1 trillion. And it comes down to an issue of leverage. You know, how do we make sure that these banks are not have so much debt, so much leverage, that if we have another problem that exists in the worldwide financial markets, that they're not going to collapse? And so one of the interesting things is they're saying to the largest banks in the world, look, we're going to require that you have to have leverage of, you know, 80% equity and 20% leverage, something that is really a safety net for the world, as well as, you know, individual consumers. They're also talking about just having greater equity requirements. These banks, and whether it's a Citibank here or whether it's a Deutsche Bank or UBS around the globe, they're saying, look, you must have equity in there so that if we run into a situation where we're going to have significant losses, that we're not going to have a financial crisis that's going to crush the entire world economy, which is what we saw in 2008, where we came as close to a worldwide depression as we have since 1929. So we have the International Financial Stability Board, as well as the International Bank, as well as the international financial gurus saying we have to make sure that we keep down the leverage, the debt, and we raise the equity. You can do that, and we can do that right here if the feds and the U.S. would require the banks to have greater equity. If you read the financial statements of the banks, you know, many of them don't have a lot of equity. They certainly are trying to use all their money they can in terms of trying to do these securitized products, which are still around. And then on the other hand, as you pointed out, we have and I have an explanation for it. We have the GOP, we have the Republicans, and many, many Democrats who now are acting on behalf of the banks to basically deregulate and take away any teeth that we had in Dodd-Frank, which was passed as a result of the crisis, as well as to give them even greater and loosen up any regulations we have on these banks.
Well, I think what's interesting here is that this entire plan, let me back up for a second. We've often described Wall Street as a casino. Because that's kind of what it's become. But even a casino has regulations that you have to have enough financial reserves in order to pay out winnings. And, you know, if it's good enough for casinos, I think it should be good enough for these banks that are lending money for people to buy homes and buy cars, you know, finance businesses. And so for there currently to not be any hard set regulations that they have to have enough money to essentially bail themselves out in the event of default, I find that almost insane that that's not already a rule. And so it is interesting that we do have, you know, the global financial regulators saying, look, this has to be done. And then we go to Washington and we see the Republicans right now cramming financial deregulation riders into bills that they know have to be passed. I mean, we're talking
the highway bill,
all kinds right. of things. So, you know, what's their end game? Why are they still pushing this?
It's all about money. It's all about money. And money in the United States, there's nothing more important than money. And maybe that's the way the world works, but I don't think so. Here, what's going on, and this all goes back to Citizens United. It all goes back to the Supreme Court. Those old men who have destroyed America and our political system by letting giant corporations, giant banks, super PACs, give money so that today, if you want to run for the U.S. Senate, you want to run for Congress, you have to raise millions of dollars. And you can't raise them. I mean, you know, we have people trying to raise them without a super PAC. Bernie is running for president, and he's able to raise some money. But it can't compare to the amount of money these banks, either directly or indirectly, can give to the coffers of somebody who is in the U.S. Senate or someone who's in the House of Representatives. That's why you have Democrats who are now going forward and saying, oh, yeah, let's loosen up the regulations. Let's let the fox eat all the chickens in the hen house. That's what's going on here in America. It's scary, and we need to stop it now. We have to stop Citizens United. We have to stop making it that it's all about who has the most money is going to succeed to help run this country. And that's where we are. And so the reason it's going on in America is because our political system and the people who make the laws basically come in with bended knee to whether it's the Koch brothers or whether it's the giant banks and their executives and the people who make the money. I want to tell you a very, you know, kind of a scary thought here, which is I was talking to some people the other day who actually they run hedge funds, and they were at a meeting and they were very concerned that we're heading for a disaster that may surpass the disaster that occurred in 2008. Mortgages right now, we have we have mortgages that are being issued in which people do not have to have any down payment. Basically zero down. We're back to where we were, and now they want to take away what regulation we have could lead to a financial disaster worldwide.
Well, you know, I think that's what's very interesting here is that we came out of this financial meltdown. Thanks to, you know, the government stepping in, bailing them out. We did have a lot of banks, Lehman Brothers, that are gone now. But the biggest problem is the fact that we didn't learn anything. We didn't hold anyone accountable. We haven't really changed the system at all to prevent this. I mean, we do have the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, which is doing some great work. But even now, that group is being attacked relentlessly by Republicans. I don't know if you saw in the Fox Business debate, this last one they had, almost every commercial break was some kind of attack ad running on the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau saying that they're the ones who aren't allowing you to get a home loan. They're not allowing you to get a car loan, and which is a total lie. But that's what we're up against here is just lies and misinformation. And we can sit here and yell the truth, but they still don't believe it, and they're not learning, and they're driving us into another crash, aren't they?
Well, potentially they are, and that's what's really scary, and that's why the international community is so up in arms. In fact, you know, one of the proposals was to have the banks raise $1.19 trillion by the year 2022 to make sure there was enough equity to deal with whatever losses may occur. The U.S. government And President Obama is no different than anybody else. They've fallen in line with these large banks. What's going on here, we have Obama, you know, he's not threatening to veto the highway bill if they put these things in there. We have Democrats that are crossing over. The whole system, I mean, I'm 65 years old. The system that I grew up with in the United States is totally bastardized as a result of Citizens United, in which you cannot run for public office. I'm talking about even local elections, unless you're raising hundreds and hundreds of thousands, and then in the national races, millions and millions of dollars. Well, who has that kind of money? Not our viewers. Our viewers may do $50 or $100 or even $1,000. We have to stop it now. We have to write our congressmen. We have to tell them, no, we're not going to allow the big banks to go forward. We need to call our senators, call our congressmen, because otherwise we're allowing these banks to run everything. It means no law, no ability to file a lawsuit and have a jury trial. Arbitration, that's one of the things they're going after right now, is that you should be forced to go into arbitration because you got a credit card. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. We have the Seventh Amendment in the Constitution, which talks about a jury of our peers.
Well, you know, that's the Republican America. This is where they want to take us. Complete deregulation, complete privatization of the justice system. You know, and the best we can do is encourage people like you just did. You got to get out there. You got to fight. You have to get active, because sitting here being passive will not cut it anymore. Fortunately, Michael, we are out of time, but thank you very much for talking with us today.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Farron.
Let's take a quick break, but when we come back, we'll hear from Ring of Fire Radio's Sam Cedar about the biggest news of the week that the corporate media won't cover. We'll be right back.
Ring of Fire is always on. Radio, YouTube, social media, and news. The news stories that matter to progressives are always available at ringoffireradio.com, along with commentary, interviews, and so much more. ringoffireradio.com.
So, Farron, this week, of course, we have seen a turn towards foreign policy, obviously in the wake of the terrorist attack in Paris. At the end of last week, President Obama has been very strong in basically telling everybody just to calm down in some respects and, maintain some measure of focus. He, of course, also was very strong in responding to the Republican sort of insanity around the idea of Syrian refugees. Some of these stories, I'm going to be talking to Ollie Grib about it a bit later from now, but some of these stories are just horrendous. But this turn to foreign policy, while it's given guys like Donald Trump a big opportunity to talk about how President Obama is letting in millions of Syrian refugees, I guess presumably through some type of underground bunker, and guys like Jeb Bush to get out there and say we need to impose a Christian test on any refugees that come in, the insanity from Ted Cruz and whatnot, this is going to hurt Ben Carson. And the timing of this is pretty stunning. But apparently, Farron, you and I are not the only people who think that Ben Carson has a foreign policy problem. Who else does, Farron?
Ben Carson, this is such a great story that came out this past week. His own advisors are terrified about the fact that he knows absolutely nothing about foreign policy. They're terrified about the fact that he doesn't seem to be learning even after all of the briefings. And these are not just briefings with people who've hopped onto the campaign. Former CIA director Michael Hayden said, I had one lengthy phone call with Ben Carson 2 months ago and his instincts are all right, but this is a database in which he's very unfamiliar. Armstrong Williams.
That's a rather diplomatic way of saying, I like his attitude. He seems like a knee-jerk right winger, but man, the guy doesn't know anything about anything.
Well, then you have Armstrong Williams. He says he's been briefed on it so many times, I guess he just froze, talking about why he can't respond to foreign policy questions like in the Fox News debate. And so what it boils down to is that these people, the people that he pays, are now scared of the fact that he could actually win the presidency. I mean, that's like me saying, oh, God, you know, I hope Ring of Fire doesn't do that well because, man, I really don't like this place. It's these he pays these people and they have no faith in him. And here's the thing with Ben Carson and the Republican Party. They wanted an outsider, not realizing that when you have somebody with no political experience at all, they don't know these things. I mean, Ben Carson never had a reason as a neurosurgeon to investigate foreign policy and learn how diplomacy works. But he does know that to be good at something, you have to have experience. As a doctor, he went to college, then medical school, then internship, then residency before he could even practice. And so, you know, someone who's done that should know that you can't just jump into this high-profile position and expect to be great at day one. And that's why his advisors are so scared.
Well, I mean, let's be honest, Farron. I mean, this guy has less knowledge of foreign policy, honestly, than your average, I think, person who's interested in politics. I mean, you know, this guy is on – he was on Fox News this last Sunday – with Chris Wallace. I mean, it's Fox News. And he was asked simply, how you defeat ISIS. And Carson said, oh, well, we would get an international coalition. He could not name a single country who would be part of that coalition. I mean, this guy is not this is beyond just the idea that, well, he's a doctor. And here's the one quote that we missed. Dwayne Claridge, not a particularly a guy who I appreciate terribly much. He was one of the people in the Iran-Contra who was indicted. But Dwayne Claridge, who was until this week, according to Armstrong Williams, the campaign manager, was one of Ben Carson's top advisors, if not his top foreign policy advisor, had this to say. This is a quote. Nobody has been able to sit down with him, speaking of Carson, and have him get one iota of intelligent information about the Middle East. Carson needs weekly conference calls briefing him on foreign policy so we can make him smart. In other words, what Claridge is saying is not only did this guy start with, to use the sort of polite parlance of Hayden, an empty data set. We cannot put any data into that set. This is a guy who cannot retain anything that involves any sophistication about foreign policy. The guy is not, look, he may be a very good brain surgeon. I have no reason to doubt that he isn't a good brain surgeon. But I don't care. If there's one national lesson we have learned in this entire fiasco that is the Ben Carson bubble, and it very well may be popping soon for a myriad of reasons, not the least of which because of some comments that he made about Terry Schiavo this week. It's going to hurt him, I think, with some of his Christian fundamentalist base. But the one thing that we have learned that Ben Carson has taught all of this country that we should be grateful is that that old saying, he's no brain surgeon, means something totally different than we thought it used to mean. We all thought it meant he's no genius. Well, now we know that it means that he's not necessarily completely adept at other things besides being a brain surgeon.
And that's all the time we have for tonight, but you can get more news, commentary, and videos on our website at ringoffireradio.com, and you can subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.